guys ready? Yeah? Serious, brother. Are you?
Yep. Yeah.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Good to see all the smiling faces. Anybody watch the game last night? Nobody watched the game last night? Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Let me ask you this. Did anybody raise their hands and cheer when the Padres won? Yeah. Hallelujah. Now is your opportunity to raise our hands and cheer for what Jesus done for us on the cross. Amen. Hallelujah. He is a worthy God. If you don't mind, let's stand and invite the presence of the Almighty God in this house. When the judge comes in, they say, all rise. Jesus is the just judge, the righteous judge that judges the depths of our heart in truth and righteousness. Lord God, we thank you that you gave us another day to honor you, Lord God, that we are here even now in your presence, Lord, that you have called us your people and you have called us to this house, Lord, gathered in your name to worship your holy name, Father. So even now, we surrender our hearts, our minds, our lives, Lord God. We exalt you, Lord. I pray that you would unite our hearts together in faith as we honor you, worship you, adore you. And we thank you for all that you've done on the cross, Lord. We thank you for tomorrow. We thank you for next week, Lord. We thank you for whatever lay ahead, Lord. We trust you. Yes. We love you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen.
Can I go from your presence? Where can I go?
Washing over. Good to be back in the house of the Lord. I was gone last week for my brother's bachelor party weekend, because apparently when you have a bachelor party now, you get a weekend. I didn't know that. I missed that train. I just got one day. But it's good to be, we are no longer bachelors because we found our groom, Jesus Christ.
Amen. I love that song, you know? We cry out for his hand to heal us. Anybody need a miracle or a healing today? God can do it, right? With men, it is impossible, but with God, what?
All things are possible.
All things, little things and big things. And God wants us to keep praying about those things. We'll talk about that today in the sermon. But
God's mercy is so great towards us, and his forgiveness. And, you know, so many people are in hospitals, various places, because they don't know what to do with the guilt of sin, the conviction of sin. And God says, come unto me, all you that are laboring and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Anybody need rest and peace for your souls today? Well, that comes from Jesus. So take a minute, walk around, say hello to people around you, welcome them. Well, a couple announcements as we get going here, and for those joining us online, this Tuesday we have our church service. We're going through the book of Matthew. Wednesday, Dan's doing a great job as we're going through an Old Testament book and how appropriate it is for today. And then on Thursday night this week is Women's Bible Study. So all the ladies are welcome to come. It's a great study, and hopefully you can join us 6:30 on Thursday night, and then Friday we have movie night. Friday night at the movies. Remember that? Friday night at the movies. So this week is God is Not Dead Part 2, which is a great movie, evangelistic movie, but also apologetics, increasing our faith. So that'll be Friday night. And then Saturday there's a big men's conference taking place up in L.A., and there's a flyer like this back there, and it tells about the conference. It starts at 8 o'clock. It's at the Anaheim Convention Center. So anybody, any of the guys that want to go, we'll be meeting here at the church, or you could just drive up there. But if you're coming to the church and need a ride, we'll be meeting here at 5:30 in the morning. So ladies, kick your guys out of the house, wake them up, tell them you've got to go to this men's conference. It's going to be a great Bible study throughout the day. And we'll get back here in plenty of time for church that night. But there's also prayer on Wednesday night at 5:30, Thursday night at 5:30, or 5, excuse me. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday at 5, and then Saturday night. So come and join us and get into God's Word throughout the week. Anybody have a praise report they'd like to share with the rest of the group today? Yes, Donna? That guy over there? Are you sure? Yeah. 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 So if you need any help painting, moving stuff, see Jim afterwards. He would love to help you, okay? Love to help you. Anybody else have a praise report today? Yes. I know. You know.
Pastor Dave, you really didn't know that.
I didn't know that. I was at church last night here, so. But against all odds, which really tells us, against all odds, you know, when something in our lives is going on that we think is impossible, God can do it. You know, he can come through. Even when it's 3-0, the other team's favor. You know, you never know, you know, how God's going to work in our lives. And so we all have different things that we can lift up to the Lord spiritually, and that we need a healing. We need a miracle to take place, and God can do it. Anybody else? Yes. Wow. Amen. Yeah, amen. Anybody else? Yes.
My daughter and my son-in-law, my grandson will be here next Sunday.
All right. They'll be in. You're not excited about it at all, are you?
No. Super indifferent.
All right. Now, this, you all should have 2 pages that look like this, right? 2 pages. Probably one of the big issues of our day. And this page here just tells us that as Christians, we need to be influencing society, not having society influencing us. So there's a lot of scripture verses there that you can look at. You know, voting starts in like 20-some days or something. Places all across the country, it's happening. But we have the most liberal, radical abortion legislation in the whole country in California. And, you know, this talks about Proposition 1 that's going to be coming up. And I encourage you to read it on your own, read the backside on your own, and, you know, get involved in the election. And I mean, even before we were born in the mother's womb, Psalms 139 says that God created us. And there's so many testimonies about how, you know, a woman decided to keep the baby and gave it up for adoption. And that baby turned out to be someone that had an amazing impact, including one of the greatest baseball players, Jeter. Judge. You know how, and then musicians and all kinds of things. So God, you know, when we abort 62 million people and then we're going to be a sanctuary state for abortions, it's crazy. Pray and vote. And well, my vote won't have any effect, you know, in California. No, it does. Pray. I mean, and look at how people are lining up that are running for office according to biblical principles. And, you know, vote biblically. It does have an impact, and that's one of the things that all these verses talk about, that we are to be lights in our culture, every one of us, lights in our culture. And, you know, God sent his prophets to many pagan countries to warn them of the judgment that was coming if they don't repent. And I think that's going to happen in America. The judgment is coming if we don't repent of our sins and turn back to God. So it's a pretty radical state, pretty radical. But we have a lot of godly people that are being raised up and to serve in public offices. So get them elected. Get them elected. Do you think we need some of those on the school boards? Get them elected. Praise God for what he's doing, and I'm just glad that all of you are here today and you got up, and it's good to see all of you. God has a purpose and a meaning for all of our lives. You're in the right place at the right time. There's nothing good on TV. You're in the right place at the right time. Tell the person next to you, God wants to use you. He wants to use you. We're going to receive our tithes and offerings. The ushers are going to come forward and, you know, trust God and believe in him in all areas of our lives. And I know that a lot of people are hurting. Their food bank is there. So, you know, help yourselves afterwards in the food pantry. And they'll bring out some chicken and different things. We were able to go to the food bank last week on Thursday, and God provided. And even the food bank, I mean, is really low on their food. And they, Will was saying they increased the prices of a lot of different things because they're so low on their food. And but your faithfulness and diligence has helped with that, and missionaries that we've sent out and other things. So praise God. Jim, you want to ask God's blessing on this?
Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, just for this opportunity to come before you. We thank you for this house that you built on a hill that shines brightly for you, Lord God. Lord, I ask that you would bless these tithes and offerings. You would use them, and above all, Lord, help us to be good stewards. I thank you for just our desire to know you better. And what better way to know you is here in your house. Bless these tithes and offerings in Jesus.
you for this time. Thank you for this church and Pastor Dave. And
yes.
It's every blessing that you pour out on us, God. And I just I pray that we would be focused on you and just serving you and being a blessing to you in the kingdom. We love you, Lord, and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Take out your sermon notes. Everybody should have some sermon notes. Take them out, and there should be some pens in your back of the seats there. You can take those out as well. And if you need a Bible, feel free to go back and get a Bible as we get into God's Word today. And you can see the title as we've been going through the book of Acts. The title in Acts chapter 12, in these 15 verses that we're going to go through, is God's miraculous rescue. God has done a miraculous rescue in each and every one of our lives, hasn't he? It's really a miracle that anybody is here today. You know, we all have sin, right? Every one of us, you would agree? Jim raised his hand, so that's good. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And while we were yet sinners, what did God do? He died for us. That's a miracle. That's miraculous. And so, you know, I asked you at the beginning of the service, how many of us need some sort of miracle in our lives today, our families' lives? And almost everybody raised their hands. The other ones need to repent and ask God's forgiveness. But, just kidding. We all need a miracle in our lives. We all need God to do something miraculous spiritually or physically in our lives today. And so we've been going through the book of Acts. And, you know, I know that sometimes you can't be here. You can always watch the sermons online. And but the summary of the book of Acts is provided for us. And the main message, go back to Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Jesus told his disciples and us today, you shall receive what?
Power.
Power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you, don't forget this part, shall be my what? Witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and even to the remotest parts of the world. So we are to be God's witnesses. And I listed some other verses from the other Gospels there for you. It says in Luke 24, verse 18, again, you are to be my witnesses, Dr. Luke said, recording the words of Jesus. In Mark chapter 16, verse 15, he tells us to preach the gospel. Preach the word. Preach the good news to whoever you come in contact with. Be a witness. Preach the word. And then in Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 to 20, it says, go and make disciples of all the nations, teaching them to obey my commands, Jesus said. The word disciples is an interesting word. It means go and make students of Jesus, students of the Bible, that we are all students, all of us, and we are to go and make other students, disciples, in Jerusalem, Judea, and even to the remotest parts of the earth. And then in the book of John, chapter 21, some of the last words, these are some of the last words of Jesus. He says to Peter and he says to all of us, tend my lambs, shepherd my sheep, feed my sheep. And so that's a responsibility of all of us. You know, we have people we run in contact to every day, divine appointments. We have, you know, people that are family members that don't know Jesus. We have people, neighbors that don't know Jesus. I mean, there's all kinds of situations where we can be witnesses, where we can be lights, we can be the salt of the earth. That's what God says to us. And then in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 13, we took a look at that. Christ's followers received the Holy Spirit, as Jesus said, and they received God's power. Tell the person next to you, you have God's power. We have his power. Hopefully our faith hasn't grown cold or our lives aren't dead, you know, that we've grown lukewarm. Hopefully that isn't the case. God wants us to be on fire for him. And so Acts chapter 2 talks about that. In verses 14 to chapter 7, verse 60, God recorded for us the rapid growth of the church that was taking place in Jerusalem. And, you know, when you start stepping out and being a light and a witness for Jesus, you know, last week we talked about there probably is going to be persecution. You will be persecuted for righteousness' sake. I mean, if you take a stand today for the Bible, I mean, there's people that mock you and criticize you and say all kinds of mean things about you. And, you know, Jesus said, hey, you can expect it. If they hated me, they'll also hate you. And there will be persecution that will result from that. I mean, there's so much persecution that we hear all the time. I looked at San Diego Union newspaper. It's a very liberal newspaper. And I looked at how they change some of the words and how they present some of their stories, and it's like it's an outright attack upon conservatism or Christians. And it's really interesting how that's being played out in America today. In chapter 8 to chapter 12, here's the Jewish persecution. But instead of stopping the Bible, like many places in the world today, what does it do? It expands it. It spreads the gospel. And so just like in Acts 1:8, now it's spreading to Judea, Samaria. And then in Acts chapter 13 to 28, Paul and his companions are going out and spreading the news throughout the whole Roman Empire. And they were in charge of the world at that time. And even it says in Caesar's own household, people were accepting Jesus. That's powerful, isn't it? And so, you know, that's kind of the flow of the book of Acts. And it's good news, wherever it is. It wasn't just the culture, the ethos wasn't just to stop in Jerusalem. It was to cross cultural lines. And doesn't matter how a person looks and what color they are. It's spread out to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and even to the remotest parts of the earth. The gospel is good news for everybody, not just for Americans. And, you know, I was just reading about some other persecution that was taking place in China. You know, China has a great underground church going on right now. Fantastic underground church. And, you know, I was reading about how a woman stepped up and she was able to get a barge and take 2 million Bibles into China. And then when she got them into China, there were people there that had already, a network had already been set up to take the Bibles and then spread them throughout China in the underground churches many years ago. And so the Bibles got spread out everywhere in China. And they're serving the Lord. You know, most of the time if they're caught, they'll put in jail. They could be killed. I mean, gulags and there's great persecution going on to Christians in Iraq and Iran and Africa and, you know, Nigeria and all these other places. But the gospel is still going forth. You know, the lady didn't know how she was going to get the money to pay for those 2 million Bibles that were taken out. So she bought the barge, and then she was able to sell the barge for enough money to cover the barge and the Bibles. See, God was working miraculously behind the scenes. And he's still working today. He hasn't stopped working. So today in Acts chapter 12, turn to Acts chapter 12. Here in this chapter, we find Peter in the center of the narrative, and then it's going to move on to Paul and the rest of the book. But the church is well established now in Jerusalem. There's Gentiles that are coming to Christ in Caesarea Philippi and Antioch, and the church is growing. Barnabas and Paul came to Antioch, which we talked to look in chapter 11. And they were teaching the people about Jesus, and the Gentiles were accepting the Lord, and the Holy Spirit was coming upon them. And they were also collecting financial support for those that were in Jerusalem because there was going to be a great famine that was going to come. And so the chapter begins with the first death of an apostle and ends with the death, and we'll take a look at this coming up. It's a great story. But it ends with the death of this Roman, very evil Roman territorial king called Herod Agrippa. Ever hear of Herod Agrippa before? And we also see God's miraculous rescue of Peter. Now, we don't know how the apostles died. The only one that we really know about is here, Peter, how he died, or not Peter, James, how he died. But history says that Peter eventually was martyred for his faith of sharing about Jesus. And he said, I am not worthy to die like my master died. And so he died upside down on a cross. That's how he died. And all the rest of the apostles died martyrs' death for their faith, except for one. Who was that?
John.
They tried to kill him, remember, burn him in a boiling pot of oil, and God supernaturally protected him. He was exiled to the island of Patmos, where God gave him the great book of Revelation, and he recorded it for us. And it says that he died, as far as we know, preaching and teaching in other places of natural causes. But here's James. James is telling people about Jesus. And the Jewish synagogue and the Sanhedrin and the chief priests and Pharisees and Sadducees didn't like the message that he was bringing. And so they enlisted a guy by the name of King Agrippa to take care of their problem. So it says in chapter 12, verse 1, about that time Herod the king laid hands on some who belonged to the church in order to mistreat him. Now, the church is not a building. It's not a building, is it? What is the church? The church is people. You are the church. Brothers and sisters in the Lord, it's not a building. And a lot of people think, you know, the church is just a building somewhere. It's not. You represent Jesus. You are the church. You are his witnesses. And a lot of people think, well, I'm not a star. You know, I don't have great gifts or you know, I'm not up front or whatever. And, you know, it's not about who's up front. God says he's given to the body gifts individually just as he wills. You know, a lot of people think, hey, the Padres are all about Machado or Soto, you know. But the pitchers have been doing a great job, haven't they? And then there's a little-known guy by the name of Jake Cronenworth. Thank you. Jake Cronenworth. And then another guy that came from a foreign country. What's his name? Kim. Hasan Kim. You know, you hear it on TV. The crowds are chanting when he comes up the bat. What are they saying? Hasan Kim. Hosong Kim, Hosong Kim. You know, they aren't saying Machado, Machado, although they do cheer for him too. Unless you're a Dodger fan, then you boo him. But those are unknown heroes, really. And all of you are part of the church body, the body of Christ, the groom of Christ. And you're all important. Every one of you are important to the body. Tell the person next to you, you're important to me. Sanhedrin. It says they laid hands on them in order to do what? Mistreat them, to persecute them. And verse 2, he had James, the brother of John, put to death with a sword. He was beheaded for his faith in Jesus, for proclaiming the gospel. You know, we've seen that in our own days. There was, 20-some guys in, I think it was Iraq or Syria, that were put in front of national, worldwide TV, And they said, this is what happens to Christians. And they went to each one of them and said, hey, deny Jesus Christ as Lord and you won't be killed. And they said, no, we can't deny Jesus. And it says every one of them was shot or beheaded for their faith. That's taken place in Nigeria, taken place all over the world, persecuted for their faith. Verse 3 says, when he, Herod, saw that it pleased the Jews. You know, he was getting kudos from the Jews because he killed these Christian people. And so when he saw that it pleased them, he proceeded to arrest Peter also, one of the apostles that was there in Jerusalem. And now it was during the days of the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. You know, Herod was gaining their favor, persecuting Christians, putting James to death. And so, hey, there's another guy here, another apostle by the name of Peter. I'm going to put him in jail. And eventually he had in his mind that he was going to kill him as well. But it was the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, so he didn't want to disrupt everybody in Jerusalem and all the Christians that were there, so he waited. There's a great verse. Romans chapter 8, verse 31. Everybody turn there. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans. In verse 29, it says, for whom he foreknew, he predestined to become conformed to the image of the Son, that he might be the firstborn among the brethren, and whom he predestined, he called. You are called. Whom he called, it says, he also justified. You've been justified through Jesus' death for you on the cross, his blood being shed for you. And whom he justified, he glorified. You know, you're going to receive the glory in heaven and your new glorified body in heaven and rewards for being faithful and diligent to Jesus. It says, verse 31, what then shall we say to these things that are already listed here? If God be for us, who can be against us? Underline that verse in your Bible. Memorize it. If God be for us, who can be against us? You know, it's a great verse. And, you know, we will experience trials. Anybody experience trials last week? We will experience trials. You know, we will experience, you know, could be financial things. It could be, you know, physical things. I mean, we go through this, those same things. But God has never left us. He will never leave you and never forsake you. Remember that verse. If God be for us, who can be against us? So verse 4, Acts chapter 12, verse 4, when he had seized him, he put him into prison. He put him into the dungeon, delivering him to four squads of soldiers. Each squad had four people, so 16 soldiers were there to guard him. You know, maybe they remember what Peter did when they came to arrest Jesus. What did he do? Took out his sword. I'll protect you, Jesus, against these soldiers. And he cut off the one guy's ear. And Jesus said, put away your sword, Peter. And Jesus picked up the ear and boop, put it back on. You know, Peter thought that, you know, he could protect Jesus, but there's a greater power to protect him. Remember, it said that Jesus could have called down legions of angels at any time. And we're going to talk a little bit about angels. But squads of soldiers to guard him, intending that after the Passover, to bring him out before the people. After Passover, he's going to bring him out. And so verse 5, kind of a changing verse here. Peter was kept in prison, but that little three-letter word, but what happened? Prayer for him was being made fervently by the church of God. God wants us to pray. How often does he say to pray? Unceasingly. About what? Everything. By everything, by prayer and supplication, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God shall guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Everything, pray. You know, I can remember my grandmother, I told you this before, praying for me. I was a rebel, you know, my younger age. And my grandmother, she was so diligent in praying and praying and praying and praying. And, you know, I told you this, that, you know, when I would go and visit her, my mom, every time I was to leave, she kept saying, she'd be right there at the door. I can picture it. Dave, I'm praying for you. And I remember that picture, my grandmother praying for me. And I think of Timothy, how it says that his grandmother was raising him in the ways of the Lord and his mom. And they were praying for Timothy, and he became such a great man of God in the scriptures. Who are we praying for? You know, you got neighbors, you got friends, you got someone that you see at Jack in the Box or, you know, the coffee shop every day, you know, Starbucks or, you know, nephews, aunts. You know, we should be praying for them. I just heard from my aunt, she lives in Portland area, that her daughter-in-law was driving this little small bike down the street, motorcycle of some type, I don't know what it was, and she was being very careful, and a guy came along, a drunk driver came along and hit her, and she had a helmet on, and she smashed her head against the windshield, and the whole left side of her body, broken bones, broken leg, tibia, fibias, all kinds of different things. And the doctor said to us, you are a miracle. You should be dead right now. When you hit that windshield, you should have died. And as soon as the family found out about it, they were just praying for her. And I just talked to her today. This was a couple months ago or yesterday. And she now is walking and you know, she's praising God and glorifying God for the miracle that happened in her life. God can do miracles. And he is doing miracles. And so prayer was being made fervently for him. Who are you praying for fervently? That they would accept the Lord, that they would grow in their faith and trust Jesus. Who is it in your life that you can be praying for? That's one thing you can do. Even as you're driving along in traffic, you can be praying for someone. You know, last night I was coming to church, and right at Highway 125, the intersection of Highway 8, the traffic was completely stopped. It was not moving. And I keep looking at my watch, and I'm going, God, you got to open up some doors here or some cars so that we can get to church. It was so stopped up. And as we got to Highway 94, the overpass, and we kept on Highway 8, we saw a car, and the traffic was completely stopped on Highway 94. And the car looked like it was about ready to go over the overpass. I don't know what happened, but, you know, I just, God, just whoever that is, you know, Lord, maybe they need salvation. And then I just prayed, God, open up the traffic. And all of a sudden, the traffic parted. Pastor Dave went through. And I got here right on time. I'm going, yes, Lord. Even in the midst of this traffic jam, horrendous traffic jam, you're still there. You know, a lot of people are praising God for the Padres, that God opened up the doors. And now there's going to be another game coming up. But we rejoice over that. But do we rejoice over people accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior? That their names are being written in the book of life. Praying. In Proverbs 15:29, it says, God promises to hear with a mind to act on the prayers of those who are righteous. In James chapter 5, verse 16 says, the effective prayer of a righteous man, a righteous woman, can accomplish much. The prayers of godly people. You know, God wants us to pray. you know, we should be praying continually for this election that's coming up. It's going to be a once-in-a-lifetime election, and it's going to determine the course of what's going to happen in America, you know? And so we should be praying. And then turn to this great verse. Turn to Philippians chapter 4. Acts, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, chapter 4. Verse 4 says, rejoice in the Padres always. No, 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 no. Rejoice in what? The Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your forbearing spirit be known to all men. The Lord is near. He is near. Then it says in verse 6, be worried and anxious about everything in your life. No, of course not. It says be anxious for what? Nothing. Little things or big things, be anxious for nothing. But what do? I bite my fingernails. You know, one lady used to come to our church and moved away to Texas or someplace. She said, when I start to worry and be anxious, I eat M&Ms. And she used to eat a pound of M&Ms. A pound. Every time she started to worry and get stressed out. I got a better answer. M&Ms with peanuts. No. But in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, shall guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Think on things that are pure, says in verse 8, true, honorable, lovely, whatever is of good repute. If there is any excellence and anything worthy of praise, let your mind dwell on these things. What happens, man? Our minds start to take off and we dwell on the negative and the critical and the pessimistic things of life. No, change that attitude. And it starts with prayer. In James chapter 5, verse 16, the effective prayer of a righteous man, a righteous woman, can accomplish much. And then turn to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, it says in verse 12, he's quoting Psalms 34 here. Peter is. Much later, after this event in Acts 12, he says, for the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous, and his ears, God's ears, attend to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. And who is there to harm you, since you prove zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for the sake of righteousness, you are what? Blessed. You are blessed. And then in the, you know, the book of Matthew, in the Sermon of the Mount, the greatest sermon ever given, blessed are you when men persecute you and lie, say all things falsely against you. And, you know, it talks about how you are blessed because you know the truth. You know what God has said to you. You know what you're doing. You know, you're serving the Lord. And you'll be persecuted, he says, for righteousness' sake. And Peter, in Acts chapter 12, go back to Acts chapter 12, verse 5. He is being persecuted for his stand for Jesus. And he's in prison now, chained to guards. He has chains on him. And a Roman guard is out front protecting so that nobody could come in and steal him away, open up the prison doors. But the church was fervently praying. Prayer changes things. I saw that on a big billboard. I loved it. Prayer changes things. And if nothing else, it changes our heart, doesn't it? And then it says in verse 6, or verse, where is it? Acts chapter 12. So Peter was in prison, prayer was being made, and on that very night when Herod was about to bring him forward, Peter was sleeping between the two soldiers. You know, I thought about that. Here he is in prison. He knows James was killed, martyred for his faith, and he's sleeping. And I thought about, when was somebody else sleeping? Remember Jesus when he was in the boat, in the back of the boat, and the apostles were there, and a great storm arose? And where was Jesus? Sleeping in the back of the boat. And the disciples went, and they said, "Wake up, Jesus! Don't you care that we're perishing?" And Jesus told them, "Hey, come on, guys." And it said, "Peace be still," and he stilled the calms. He made the seas calm. Peace. And then he gave a great story there. And, you know, here they are. Their church is praying for him. Peter's sleeping. Man, he knows God's in control, whatever happens. And it says, he was sleeping between the two soldiers, verse 6, bound with chains, and guards in front of the door were watching over the prison. And then, behold, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared, and a light shined in the cell. And it struck Peter's side and roused him and said, "Get up quickly," and his chains, what? Fell off his hands. Now, remember, the church was praying. Here's an answer to their prayers. Peter is going to be miraculously rescued. You know, it says in the Bible that we should show hospitality to people because you never know if you're entertaining an angel unaware. Divine appointments. You never know if that's an angel that you're entertaining. Amy, you never know, you know, if your husband here is an angel. You go, "Yeah, I know he's not an angel." But we never know. I mean, there's people that have come to the church and they ask for something, you know, food or, you know, some ways that we can help them. And I keep thinking, you never know if that's an angel that God has brought here just to see if we're really doing what the Bible says we should be doing. And I remember that driving when my parents lived in Tucson, Arizona, and I was so tired. I drove from San Diego State to Tucson in one night, and I was falling asleep at the wheel. I kept going off to the side island and coming back and going to the side island and coming back. And so I turned on I didn't have air conditioning. I rolled down the manual windows, air conditioning, and, you know, getting the air in there. I turned on the radio real loud, and it still wasn't helping. And as I'm driving along, I started to drift off to the side, and a bird came out of nowhere and struck me in the side of my head in my car and woke me up and then flew out the other window. And I was able to get the rest of the way to my mom's place in Tucson. And I was going, God, my grandma was praying. But God sent a ministering servant. God sent miraculously, you know, an angel in disguise in the form of a bird. You know, you never know. But I think he does that. Angels are ministering servants sent for the saints, sent for us. And when our time is over and we're, you know, it's time to go, that, you know, we can't say, "God, you can't take me now. I got the Padre series coming up." No. I mean, when it's our time, it's our time. And God does answer the requests of his people. And, you know, again, Peter was eventually martyred upside down for his faith. And I think Peter and so many of you here will hear the words, "Well done, good," and what? "Faithful servant." Now, sometimes God's answer is wait. Yellow light, wait. It's not time yet for me to be glorified. And Sometimes his answer is no. You're asking according to the wrong desires. Turn to James chapter 4. James chapter 4. It says, what is the source of quarrels and conflicts among you? Is not the source your pleasures that wage war in your members? You lust, verse 2, and do not have, so you commit murder. Man, we just saw last night, you know, she was sharing about the murder that took place right here in San Diego. Murders every night in Chicago and Philadelphia and these other places and here in, you know, our little towns. It says you commit murders. You are envious and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. And you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask with what? Wrong motives. We ask with wrong motives. You know, I've heard, you know, people pray that, hey, God, send me a millionaire. You know, I need a husband. I need a wife. Send me someone, you know, rich sugar baby, God. Please, God, I've got these pants hanging on my bedstand. Please fill them with a man. Actually, someone prayed that once. But no, that's with the wrong motives. It says you ask with the wrong motives. And it says that you can spend it on your own pleasures. Verse 4, you adulterous, do you not know that friendship with the world is hostility towards God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself a what? Enemy of God. You know, we pray, we let God decide what is best for us, that he would be honored, that he would be glorified. You know, I hear a lot of people say, well, I'm starving. I have no food. Well, are you willing to work? You know, the scriptures say, if a man doesn't work, neither will he eat. You know, I mean, and I know there's sometimes other circumstances going on, but maybe God wants to use a secondary agency to meet that need. Another brother or sister, or, you know, somehow God will provide. What does God want? Do we ever ask that question? What would you receive the honor and glory from God? What is your will in this situation? You have because you do not ask, but, you know, you ask sometimes with the wrong motives. God says, keep praying. Pray unceasingly. Philippians 4. Don't stop. Have faith. God wants us to have faith. Peter was sleeping. Church was praying. He was bound in chains. The prison doors were locked and bolted. Do you think God forgot about him? Whatever your circumstances are today, whatever those are watching online, those people, has God forgotten about you? No, he hasn't forgotten about you. You know, he said to his disciples, follow me. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And then in Psalms 34, it says, the angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and rescue him. You know, one thing I've asked the Lord for 41 years, God, provide your angels as the saints are gathered together around this building. Provide your angels that they would just protect, you know, the people as we're having services here. You know, I mean, and thank God for his protection over the people that come to this place Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night, Saturday night, you know, Sunday mornings. Thank you, Jesus. And there's a great illustration. Turn to 2 Kings. That's in the Old Testament. Second Kings, verse 6. A godly man by the name of Elisha, and he says his servant, they were coming to take Elisha and eventually to kill him, and they sent horses and chariots, and there was this great army that was coming for Elisha. And it says, what shall we do, his servant, in verse 15. Now when the attendant of the man had risen early and gone out, and there was this army with horses and chariots, and they were circling the city, and his servant said to him, my master, what shall we do? And you may be at that point in your life, and you're just going, man, I'm frustrated, I'm confused, I just don't know what's going on. I'm upset. I'm angry. God, what should I do? And he asks Elisha. And it says in verse 17, Elisha prayed. First thing to do is pray. Not the last thing. First thing. He prayed. And it says, and he said, O Lord, I pray, open my servant's eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he saw. And behold, the mountain where they were was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. God had sent his angels, and there was chariots and fire and all kinds of things. And then when they came down to him, Elisha prayed, and it says the Lord struck this people with blindness. You know, God was in charge, wasn't he? He was in charge. You know, sometimes, you know, it says our battle is not against flesh and blood in Ephesians, but against principalities and powers and forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. It starts with our knees being in prayer. You know, James, it says, not this James, but the other James, there was two of them, it says he had a nickname. His nickname was Camel Knees. Because he had spent so much time every day in prayer that he had calluses on his knees from praying. You know, we don't have to be on our knees praying, but maybe our faces to the ground, maybe with our hands raised up. You know, maybe, you know, at any time, at any place, God hears the prayers of the saints. You know, you could be driving along and you could be praying. Just don't close your eyes. Use that time to pray. And Elisha was praying, the saints were praying. Go back to Acts chapter 12, we'll finish this up here. So what happened? The angel came. I don't know if it was Angel Gabriel or Michael or one of the other powerful angels. But it says the angel struck Peter's side, rousing him. Get up. His chains fell off. Verse 8, the angel said, gird yourself. Put on your sandals. And he did so. And he said to him, wrap your cloak around you and follow me. And he went out and continued to follow this angel. And he did not know that what was being done by the angel was real. But he thought he was seeing a vision. And they had passed the first guard, the second guard. They came to the iron gate that leads out to the city, which opened for them, because they had one of those openers. No, it was a supernatural opening, right? Opened for them by itself. And they went out and went along the street, and then immediately the angel departed from him. And Peter came to himself, and he said, now I know for sure the Lord has sent forth his angel and rescued me from the hand of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting. God rescued him. Tell the person next to you, God wants to rescue you. He wants to do a miracle. He's still doing miracles. He's still in the job of doing miracles. And God wants us to be people of prayer. Ask. And it says, and when they realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, who was called Mark. We talked about John Mark. And, you know, he had some problems with some of the apostles, including Paul. And then Paul, later in John Mark's life, called for him to come and minister with him. But this family was friends of Jesus and was friends of Peter. And many were gathered together, verse 12 say, and what were they doing? praying. The church was gathered together praying. And when he knocked at the door of the gate, a servant girl named Rhoda, don't name your daughter Rhoda, came to answer. And when she recognized Peter's voice because of her joy, she forgot to open up the gate and ran in and announced to that Peter was standing in front of the gate. And they said to her, we'll talk about this more. You're out of your mind. You're crazy. You're seeing things. But she kept insisting that it was so. And they kept saying, well, it's just his angel. You know, they had this tradition that all of us have an angel that looks like us. That was part of their tradition. They said, well, it's just your angel. And it says, but Peter kept knocking, let me in. And when they opened, they saw him, and they were what? They were amazed. You know, they were amazed. I mean, we would be amazed if we saw how God is working. Working in government, working in nations, working across the world, working in individual lives. God is working. You just keep being obedient. You keep serving him. You keep doing what he tells you to do in his word. And here we have this miraculous rescue. God is doing miracles. It's a miracle, really, that any of you are here today. While we were yet sinners, God died for us. It's a miracle. Somehow you heard the good news and you said, hey, I want to accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And remember, God says, I have the Holy Spirit empowering you. And the church was praying. Working. God was working, even though we don't see it. God was protecting. God sends birds in the middle of the night to fly through your windows. You know, is there anything impossible with God? Nothing. Remember that verse? Nothing. With men, it might be impossible, but with God, what? All things are possible. One last verse. Turn to Matthew chapter 10. I sure am long-winded. Matthew chapter 10, verse 28. Do not fear those who kill the body, but they're unable to kill the soul. But rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in Gehenna, which is the term for hell, the final place of punishment. We should not fear what man can do to us, but have an awesome fear of what God can do, right? The judgment of God. And then it says, verse 29. He gives an illustration. He says, are not two sparrows sold for a cent? And yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from the Father. You know, if you watch baseball, you know, in L.A. there was a bird that flew through the stadium in the middle of a game. What was it? A goose or a geese, whatever. So it was a goose. And so, you know, in the Padre game, you see all these people holding up these fake gooses, you know. Yeah, that's why they were holding them up. And I was going, why are they holding up these gooses? You know, but because of what happened and what did you say? Rally goose. They call it a rally goose, yeah. I'm going, this is crazy, but rally gooses, rally geese. Oh Lord, help us. So these sparrows were sold for a cent, but here's the point: not yet one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. God knows about them, And then he says in verse 30, the very hairs of your head are numbered. Therefore, do not fear. You are of more value than these geese, these gooses. Every one of them shall confess me before men, and I will confess them before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever shall deny me before men, I will deny him before my Father who is in heaven. Let's all pray. God, I pray that we would confess you, that we would have that personal relationship with you, Lord, that we would not grow cold or dull or lukewarm in our faith, but that we would be on fire for you. I know, Lord, people online and people here in this room, many of them are going through hard times. These are hard times, inflation, 8.2%, people out of work, all kinds of different things going on in their lives, Lord. It's tough. They're tough times. These are times when we need to call upon you. Peter was in a tough place, God, but prayers were being offered by the saints for him and his protection. And you open up the doors supernaturally. It was a miracle. And God, that some of us need little miracles, big miracles in our lives. You tell us to cast all of our cares upon you because you love us. You love every person here in this room today, every person watching online. Confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord, Savior, Creator, and you will be saved. For apart from you, we can do nothing. We need you more than ever in our lives, Lord. Physical things going on, mental things going on, spiritual things going on, Lord. We need you. God, that we would put our lives in your hands. You're in control, Lord. Whatever you want, that you would be honored and you would be glorified. And Lord, as we're gathered here today, the disciples were taking communion together, and it says that there were many people that are sick, and some of them have died in the Corinthian church because of sin in their lives. Because they've rebelled against you. They've blown it. They've blatantly have gone off the wide road that leads to destruction. And Ananias and Sapphira, how you struck them dead at the altar because they lied against God, the Holy Spirit. And Lord, maybe there's people here today that they need a change in their lives. They need to repent of some evil, some sin in their lives. Lord, going forward, that they would have their sins washed away as far as the east is from the west, having your blood set them free, the chains broken. As we're here in this room and those watching online, if you are that person today, you need to have those chains broken. You need to have your sins forgiven. Just raise your hand right now and say, yes, Lord, that's me. I need that today. Thank you, Jesus. We ask your forgiveness. We ask for healing in our lives. Set us free, Lord. We want to worship you. We want to put you first in our lives. Thank you for loving us so much that you gave your son to die on the cross for us. We ask forgiveness. You are faithful and righteous to forgive us. We ask you to heal us. Lord, you can heal us right now. Heal us, Lord. Set us free. Set the captives free. And we ask this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Let's all stand. Remember all the different things that are going on this week. Tony, what time is the guys meeting here on Saturday? 5:15. We leave at 5:30. So if you're going to come, you know, come. Women, don't forget Thursday night and the other Bible studies throughout the week. They're all online. You can watch them online. Tuesday, this week, anybody that thinks that you are a senior, senior Bible study. What time is it? 10? 10:30 on Tuesday. Okay, so come and join us. We have a great group, support group, encouragement. You know, a lot of people aren't working or retired or whatever. Come and join us. We have a lot of fun together. So that's this Tuesday. And, man, it's great to be part of the family of God. We need each other. We need to encourage each other. We need to pray for one another. We need to be washed and cleansed with God's word. So let's sing our closing song. Great song to close with. How great is our God? We serve a great God. And he loves every one of us here in this room. And he knows the number of hairs on our head. Tom, I'm sorry, man. You know, He knows everything about us. There's nothing we can hide from him. He wants us to love him with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Amen? Amen. Tell the person next to you, I'm glad I was here today. God bless all of you. Have a great day.